Leadership Lecture Series brings to our community individuals who are role models for Bishop students. Through their leadership and their extraordinary achievements in their community as well as the nation. Today we are thrilled to have Dr. Terrence Roberts join us as this year's Endowed Leadership Lecturer. I would like to invite to the podium eighth graders Jenna Park and Simran Diokule to introduce Dr. Roberts. Readings from Lessons from Little Rock. I walked to the Crystal Burger, a hamburger joint in Little Rock, where my favorite order was burgers, fries, and a chocolate malt to go. The Crystal Burger was a white-owned establishment. I'd been there many times before, and I knew the rules very well. Black people could not eat the food that they'd purchased while still inside the Crystal Burger. They could not occupy any of the counter stools or chairs around the tables, and they could only order food to go. This day was no different, except that right after placing my order, I hopped up on one of the stools at the counter to wait for my burgers and fries. It was most certainly out of character for me to do that. I don't remember why I decided to sit on the stool that day. It just felt like an ordinary 13-year-old kind of thing to do while I waited. Suddenly, there was absolute silence. I'd forgotten the script.
On September 4th, 1957, Terrence Roberts and other African-American students, known as Little Rock Nine, made an unsuccessful effort to integrate Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. Despite the presence of the National Guard, the angry mob of about 400 segregationists filled the streets leading to the school. 19 years later, the students attempted to re-enter Central High, now through a sea of 1,000 protesters. The following day, President Dwight D. Eisenhower sent U.S. Army troops to escort the students to the school for protection. The troops were stationed at the school for the entirety of the school year, although they were unable to prevent incidents of violence inside. In 1999, Dr. Roberts and the other members of the Little Rock Nine were awarded the Congressional Gold Medal by President Bill Clinton.
Speak with us this morning and spend time with students and faculty throughout the day. Since 2004, the Endowed Leadership Lecture Series has accorded the Bishop's Medal to 13 recipients. At this time, as he begins to share his story with us, I honor Dr. Roberts with this medal.
You know, one of the things that happens to me as I come into venues like this one is I take a reading of the temper, the atmosphere, and I found Bishop School to be a very warm, inviting area for me, an arena. Thank you for that. Thank you for welcoming me with open arms and lots of good food. Yeah, I set some of it on my jacket. So, we're going to talk a little bit about Little Rock. But we're going to spend the bulk of our time talking together. I don't know the timelines and all of that. But we're going to start with a short DVD. So this will play on for a bit, and then we will move on to other things.
Uh-oh. Fall 1957, non-black children with the hope of a better education faced tremendous backlash as they integrated the best school in town, the all-white Central High School.
That was the prevailing message, that things were separate and equal. But of course, there was no question they were separate and unequal.
We were interested in simply getting an education and having the option.
I never saw a new book, and I knew that in Central, they had new books.
I will not force my people to integrate against their will.
Mob screaming, shock, real shock.
So the mob was coming, they were going to take over, they were looking for us, they wanted to kill us.
Oh my goodness, they hated me.
We've always had segregation. That's what people want.
That's a great unfinished agenda.
Today, 50 years later, we look back to see how far we've come since that day, and ultimately how far we need to go.
We are very much in crisis.
The dropout problem is huge.
Segregated schools are like death sentences.
Who decided that when you have predominantly African-American students together, that that's not a good thing?
We have to figure out a way that across the board, students everywhere in this country are held to the same rigorous academic standards.
If we choose to dumb down our educational system, then we have made very little use of our money. How dare we be so stupid?
We all have the children. You can't just fold them into the lion's den and say, have to come out today.
Until we all stop pussyfooting around the real issue, then Central can't change, but I don't know that our nation can.
Brown v. Board guaranteed access. It didn't do the next best thing, which was to ensure equity.
Is it time to celebrate, or are we still in crisis?
Today we are free but not equal. This, the operative word today, is not freedom, it's equality.
There's nothing wrong with this country that can't be fixed by the things that are going right in this country. It's just that in education, we have not been able to replicate excellence.
Over the next hour, we will take to the road to find answers to some of the most pressing issues confronting our children and their education today. And with the help of students, parents, teachers, and educators, we're going to grade the state of education in America. Join us as we examine Black education in America on Lessons from Little Rock, a National Report Card.
Just think, what if those 9 kids 50 years ago had sat home with their parents and talked about how wonderful Brown v. Board of Education was, and wouldn't it be nice if someone went to Central High? Right? That's a conversation anybody can have. Wouldn't it be nice if someone would go and integrate Central High School? I mean, it's the best high school you could ever imagine, and if someone could get an education there, wouldn't it be nice? But it all was possible to unfold as it did because they didn't say, wouldn't it be nice? They said, here am I, Lord, send me.
It's dawn here in Little Rock, Arkansas. The kids are getting ready for another typical day of school. In an hour or so, these halls will be bustling with a mosaic of students. However, in 1957, this high school, Central High School, was a very different place. It was 100% white, but not for long. What happened that fall was pretty simple. Black parents in Little Rock wanted their children to be able to go to the best school in town, not just the separate but not so equal segregated high school. The rest, as they say, is history. In 1954, the Supreme Court's Brown versus Board of Education decision dismantled segregation in all public schools across the country. By 1957, blacks in communities like Little Rock, Arkansas, wanted to put the new law into practice.
That was the prevailing message, that things were separate and equal. But of course, you could see that. There was no question they were separate and unequal. Central High is a very imposing, very large edifice. Dunbar, which was at the time the only black high school, is sort of a smaller replica of Central. Very same concept, but much, much smaller.
Dunbar had very outstanding teachers, but again, when it came to science and mathematics and the technology, Central had all the resources.
At the beginning of the school year, a dump truck came and dumped the books at the front of Horace Mann, and then the teachers had to go and pick them out and use them. I never had a book that didn't have all the names and Debbie Loves Roy and all that stuff in it. I never saw a new book, and I knew that in Central they had new books.
There were 517 black students living in the Central High School District. 80 signed up to go, 17 were selected. But in the end, only 9 decided to attend Little Rock Central High in September of 1957.
What did all of my other 12th grade classmates know that I didn't know? Why was I the only one in the senior class that had agreed to transfer?
On September 4th, 1957, Ernest Green, Melba Pizzillo, Terrence Roberts, Thelma Mothershed, Minnie Jean Brown, Elizabeth Eckford, Gloria Ray, Carlotta Walls, and Jefferson Thomas, the kids who became known as the Little Rock Nine, were not prepared for what happened.
I will not force my people to integrate against their will. I believe in the democratic processes and principles of government wherein the people determine the problems on the local level, which is their right.
We assumed that the guard was there to keep the peace. I naively believed that and walked up there and literally tried to walk through the line of guards. There's these two guards looking at me as if I'm crazy. Yeah. You think you're coming in here? Are you kidding?
At the other end of the school was where Elizabeth Eckford was encountering this mob of people behind her and trying to simply get out of harm's way and get on a bus and get out of there.
She had come earlier. I didn't even realize it. She was sitting on a bus bench, petrified with fear.
And when I got home and watched the news footage, I had some idea of what Elizabeth had encountered. It dawned on me that this was going to be more than just trying to get across those lines.
The Little Rock Nine literally walked head on into local racism at its ugliest. What happens next changes the course of history when Lessons from Little Rock, a National Report Card returns.
Well, I'm not really going to return to that, but if you'd like to see it in its entirety, it is Lessons from Little Rock, produced and directed by Shola Lynch. Google and find out. In any case, we're going to talk a little bit about some of that. You've got a glimpse of what we were up against. It all started for me on December 3rd, 1941. And I came charging out of the womb after a very pleasant 9-month gestation period. With an anticipation that I would join a group of human beings who were glad to see me. That was not to be. People in Little Rock were pretty much aligned against me, or these people liked me. I was told that I had a significant handicap, a liability, if you will, and that was being clothed in black skin. The message was, black skin is not the proper clothing for a true and real human being. Boy, watch out. You step across the line and we will kill you. And of course, there were precedents for that. I quickly learned that in order to survive life in Little Rock, I needed to be very, very careful and to do things according to the law. And then in 1954, the law changed. But I was intrigued because the wording of that Supreme Court decision in 1954 said, quote, it is no longer constitutional to discriminate. I perked up, no longer. Let's go back and find out when this stuff started. I got all the way back to the year 1619. Some of you in your study of American history will find 1619 to be a very relevant date. By the way, since we're talking about things historical, I might as well add in here that often people think about history as stuff that happened years ago and no longer has relevance. Nothing could be further from the truth. Everything, and that includes everything that you can think of, everything that happens in time or space, simply and merely happens to be antecedent to everything else that will happen later. There's a continuous, unbroken thread. And so the line from 1619 to 1954 is unbroken. And during that period of time, which by the way, is 335 years, for 335 years, it was legal in this country to discriminate against people based on racial group membership. I want you to let that sink in because that is so important for us in our discussion. If you do something for 335 years, what's the likely outcome? Well, you get good at it. You develop a relationship with it. It becomes normative. 335 years tells me this is how it is supposed to be. And so in 1954, when the law changed, nothing really changed except the law. Because with 335 years of input, you don't give it up simply because 9 members of the Supreme Court stand up and unanimously say no. By the way, there's a story behind that 9-0 vote. You should ferret that out, not as simple as it may seem. But in any case, I was reading Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outlier, recently, and in that book, he talks about the need for us to engage in 10,000 hours of practice if we want to develop expertise in any given area of human endeavor. 10,000 hours. Lights came on. How many 10,000-hour periods are there in 335 years? Huh? So I did the math, and I came up with 294. And then, the weight of that almost crushed me. We, the people of these United States of America, are practiced in the art of discrimination to the 294th power. Wow. And even if you're not a mathematician, somebody who is even remotely concerned about things mathematical, the weight of that gets to you, got to me, the 294th power, tells me that I, Terry Roberts, am up against stuff as a resident of these United States. In any case, but still, going back to that year and 1984, I was thrilled that the law changed. Not everybody was thrilled, of course, based on what I just said. In fact, over 100 members of our own U.S. Congress pinned their names to a document that we know as the Southern Manifesto. In the document, these Congress people pledged to do whatever they could do to prevent implementation of this dreaded Brown decision. Has some familiar ring, right, in today's Congress and what they're doing. Well, in any case, though, I'm still ecstatic. Because this meant the law was on my side. For the first time, the law supports Terry Roberts. I joined this group of nine for a number of reasons, not the least of which was the fact that the law was on my side. And as you saw, and as you heard, it wasn't easy because the governor and his minions came out in force, determined to keep us out. And they were successful. We were not able to get into school until some weeks later. And even then, only with the help of the U.S. Army. By the way, without the Army there, I'm very convinced we would have all been killed. You would have been honoring nine corpses today. But as it was, the Army was there the entire year, and that's the answer to the question, how long were they there? They had to be there. In fact, Ernie Green, our only senior, graduated that year. He was allowed to go to the ceremony, but the others of us were not. That was deemed too dangerous, so the Army went on our behalf. Ernie and the Army went to his graduation. And it was a rather weird kind of graduation for him because ordinarily in American high schools, especially American public high schools, graduation is a loud, raucous, noisy affair. As each graduate approaches the podium to receive his or her diploma, bells and whistles and air horns and balloons and all that stuff, earning complete silence. He said he could hear the tap, tap, tap of his heels as he walked across that wooden platform to receive his diploma. But he was satisfied that he would be able to accomplish that. I would have graduated from that institution had not the governor intervened the next year and closed down all public high schools in Little Rock. The governor, this guy, all the fathers, by the way, he was not the only one of his ilk to do such a thing. The governor of West Virginia in Prince Edward County closed down not just the high schools, but the elementary schools, middle schools, and the high schools for four consecutive years. In the name of segregation forever. Now, you might think that's a bit extreme, but for the folk who were doing it, it was not extreme at all. This was the only way they thought they could preserve a favorite way of life. And so it was. In Little Rock, we met this extreme opposition. But we persevered for a number of reasons, not the least of which, for me, as I said, was the law change, but also the fact that I knew from my own study that thousands of people who lived before me had laid down their lives in this same struggle. And I could not say no to my opportunity. That would have been tantamount to turning around and spitting on the graves of folk who had sacrificed everything in order for me to be in that position in Little Rock. Not a favorite position, certainly, but at least a better position than they were in. There were possibilities. There was hope. There was this notion that somehow people would wise up and really begin to believe those words we recite when we pledge allegiance to the flag of liberty and justice for all. I sometimes am amused when I hear large groups of people repeating those almost by rote. not understanding what they truly mean. But in any case, we suffered as a group of nine that year, as you might well imagine. In fact, anything that you can think of that one human being might possibly do to another, that's what they did to us. Those of you who are interested in the blood and gore, yes, we were beaten, we did bleed, we cried. Melba's book is called Warriors Don't Cry, but that's not the whole truth. We cried copious tears. In any case, we made it through. And it's one of those situations where you learn a lot about yourself. I learned a lot about myself. I learned to own my own fear. This is my fear, after all. Other people aren't making me afraid. I choose fear in the face of these crazy folk who want to kill me. Once I understood that it was my fear, it became much more manageable. Fear does not have to interfere with goal-directed behavior. And that's true. Whatever frightens you here at Bishop, it's probably a few things. I don't know. For some of you, you're like I was at your age. Most frightening thing with the girls. But you can deal with that. Okay. In any case, we got through the year, and I was all set to return. I wanted to go back and finish, because in spite of all the craziness, I thought it's incumbent upon me to continue this whole process. But the governor steps in and closes the school. Now, the governor, you know, I can just imagine the dilemma he faced. He did not support integration. He was an avid segregationist, but he didn't quite know what to do. I can just imagine him tossing and turning in the governor's mansion, you know, soiling the government-supported linen, and trying to figure out what to do, what to do. And all of a sudden, he got this idea, aha, I will close the schools. Ah, that will keep the white kids out. But the governor forgot. That would keep the white kids out. See, the governor wasn't necessarily a bright person. I didn't say that. In fact, when you think about it, there is no requirement for holding public office in this country that you have a measurable IQ. You simply have to be age appropriate, that is, chronologically eligible, and then have enough money to pay for the filing fee. And then, if you can have enough idiots out there who vote for you, you can get to office. Well, after all, I'm in San Diego. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to invite some of you who have questions, because we don't have much time. We're on this tight schedule. So we have here a wonderful invention, a microphone, for you to come down and give us. Now, if you are uncomfortably seated and it's too hard for you to get out, just stand where you are and speak your question loud. We'll go from there. And we have to do this rather quickly, given our time constraints. Yes. The bravest soul in the building. Right here in the city. What she doesn't know at this point is I'm going to forbid her use of the word like.
I was.
You know, it was one of those rare times when I was in the cafeteria with Minnie Jean. I saw this whole thing unfold as she stood over this kid wondering what to do, and she finally did dump her old chili and stuff on him, and the next day the favor was returned, and from that point on, it was open warfare with Minnie Jean and her tormentors, for which she was expelled from school, by the way. She got kicked out. She got kicked out. The very next day, little cards were circulated throughout that entire campus. One down, eight to go. And they cranked the pressure up on the rest of us. But we, the eight, we committed ourselves to nonviolence, saying no matter what you do, we're not going. Because we saw what was happening. They could not succeed using that for it. They have to come up with something else. Thank you. Great question.
Thank you.
Anytime. So here comes question number two. And question number three, you can come down too.
The question is, how would the tables have been turned if whites had been forced to integrate into a black school? Mm-hmm.
Wow, that is a purely hypothetical question. However, I would speculate that it would not have been so traumatic. Part of what's been happening historically in terms of the relationship between black people and white people is that black people have had to figure out how to live and exist with people who didn't want them. But they have been very nurturing. In fact, a lot of black children have had opportunity to build relationships with young white children because a lot of black women are nannies for white babies. And when families go on vacation and leave those babies in their care, they would bring them to our neighborhood. This was fairly common in Little Rock, for instance. So I think because of that and other things, there wouldn't be that animosity. Thank you. Inspired me. You know, I really, even as a young kid, as a 15-year-old kid, I understood that if people had access to information, to knowledge, to whatever was out there in the universe that would make life really good for them, they would want it. And I think a lot of folk who choose to follow the ideology of racism, they haven't yet figured that out. They bought into something that's very narrow and very limiting, and they think that's all there is. Tragically for them, they never find out if they don't shift or change. But I think I had that understanding even then. Thank you. So it becomes economically important to maintain the way things are. I don't know that that's absolutely true, but I see enough examples to let me know that it might be a real problem. Thank you.
Do you ever have a
Well, you know, I think I did. I can't recall the exact moment, but there was a period during that year when it suddenly dawned on me that what was going on here was something momentous, something much bigger than 9 kids going to school. And I don't know how it all came and what forces were there to teach that to me, but I did feel that thing.
What was the first morning like for you?
Okay, and that one was grammatically correct. That first morning, I do believe, in my naivete, I thought, I knew the guards were there at school by then. I knew they were there, but I naively thought they were there really to keep the peace. I went up as a very naive 15-year-old, thinking that people in Little Rock would be voicing their opposition.
Yes.
Giving loud voice to their opposition. But I thought they would do that to go home, or to work wherever people go during the day. But no, they had pledged to be there until we were gone, which was really a problem. Thank you. Because I was so afraid, but I don't know if that's true. But thank you. I'll work on that one. The youngest of the group was Carlotta Lanier. At that time, her name was Carlotta Walls. She was 14. I was 15. Some of the others were 16. Thank you. Reiterate some of the things I said before, and that is because I knew the law was on my side, and I had great appreciation for the sacrifice of those who came before me. But also in addition to that, I think what I read in the faces of my parents, they saw this very narrow window of opportunity that wouldn't be open for very long, and they were willing to go through it, and they were on my side. Thank you.
How do you feel that America's doing today in terms of issues of equality?
Ah, loaded question. How is America doing? We're not doing all that well, actually. In fact, people sometimes chide me for not applauding the progress that we've made, but I don't think it's time to celebrate the progress. I will use what I call my Malcolm X response here. Malcolm was once chided for the same thing, and he said, look, you have plunged a 10-inch knife into my back. You have now removed the blade 2 inches, and you want to celebrate progress? We've got an 8-inch misunderstanding. Thank you.
Thank you. How you said that Betty Jane was expelled, what was your guys' reaction? Like, were you guys scared that one of you guys were going to get expelled for nothing?
Well, you know, that fear was there, no question about it, because you could never tell what the school officials might do. But more than that, we felt really good that she had begun to fight, because she was fighting on our behalf. We all wanted to punch somebody, even though publicly we were nonviolent. We harbored these very violent impulses. Thank you.
Have you ever felt later in your life that people were still discriminative and hated you sometimes?
Well, unfortunately, yes, because even though that's not the crux of the matter, individual bigotry is one thing, but to have a society that is devoted to maintaining racist policies, that's quite another. But I haven't had that sort of stuff, and I haven't had much of it lately, but it's never pleasant. Never pleasant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Education inequality persists today, and I was wondering what your thoughts are on possible solutions to that.
In terms of the inequality in education? You know, I have a lot to say about education. I won't have time here, but I don't think the way we deal with education in this country is very fruitful. We play games with it. Historically, especially in public school education, not so much in private schools, but in public school education, the goal was not to teach people to think. The goal was to turn out workers who were obedient, who would get to work on time, and had good work ethic. And a lot of energy went into that with some of the mega barons of the time. But we have not recovered from that. So a lot to talk about. We may have a chance to talk about that later, but thank you. I love that. Good question. I went to LA High in Los Angeles. By the way, LA High at that time was probably the most completely desegregated school in the entire city, which meant that I had this opportunity to interact with people from all groups and cultures. It was great. Thank you.
What are your thoughts on the term reverse racism?
I think it's ludicrous. Because it's either racism or it's not.
I guess.
Specifically, how do you feel about the backlash from certain whites who say that blacks are racist against white people?
Well, they're probably true. I know black people who feel very racist toward white people. So there's some, logic in that. But it's all racism. It's not reverse. It's not backwards.
Thank you for coming today.
Well, my pleasure. Thank you.
As I was sitting here, I was thinking about a book I read in ninth grade. It was called The Sunflower. And basically, there's this scene where a Nazi soldier asks for forgiveness from a Jewish member of the camp, blanking out the words. But my question is, did you ever have anyone from the school that was white come up to you and apologize?
Oh, yes. See, for me, forgiveness was there a priori, even before the act. They were forgiven. That's my choice in the world. There were, of course, in any group of people, you can always count on the fact that not everybody thinks the same way. Always people in groups who have a different way of thinking, and there were white kids at Central who didn't hate us, which was very good. Thank you for bringing that up. Well, when Barack Obama became the first black president, I thought, this man doesn't know what he's in for. And it turned out to be true. He's learning, but it's been quite a lesson for him. Thank you.
Did either of your parents try to oppose you from going to the Central
High? No, both my parents were absolutely supportive. They said, we'll support your decision 100%, which was good. Because you see, I had my argument already. I was going to pay my argument, so didn't have to. Thank you.
Did you find it hard to be able to rely on a soldier, maybe to protect you during those hard circumstances?
Yes, and I found it hard because I am a person who likes to do things myself, and I find it difficult now to rely on anybody to do anything for me, which is a flaw I've discovered, because at heart, I do believe I should be able to cooperate and allow people to do things for me, especially as I age, because I'm right now temporarily able-bodied. At some point, I'll be less than able-bodied. I'm going to need to depend on folks, so I need to change that. Thank you for reminding me.
In Ms. Ahmed's classroom in the sixth grade area of the school, but let's